Hello, my name is Colm Fitzgerald. I'm a member of the Education Committee of the Actuarial Association of Europe, and I teach on the UCD Actuarial and Financial Studies degree course. I'm going to talk to you today about what is an actuary, why do they exist, and what can they do? So, what is an actuary? Well, there's many ways to define what is an actuary, but I'm going to use a simple and broad approach, which is used by the Society of Actuaries in Ireland, namely that an actuary is a professional with a skill set to use numbers to make judgments about the future. Actuaries mostly work in insurance companies or in relation to pension funds, where being able to make judgments about the future is critically important. For example, being able to estimate the size of your pension when you retire. But the actuarial skill set is also quite broad, and actuaries can work in much broader areas too. So what is this actuarial skill set? Well, there's three elements to it. The first is that it is quantitative, as in it's related to numbers. The second is that it is multidisciplinary. And thirdly, it is socially responsible. Let's look at the first of them. So the quantitative nature of actuarial work. Well, as you can probably expect, what actuaries do can be quite complex mathematically. However, it can also be explained very simply. Actuarial work mostly involves determining answers related to the following equation. What does this equation mean? Very simply, what it means is that actuaries need to be able to estimate the expected cash flows that will arise at various times in the future, and they need to estimate them in today's money terms. A very simple example of this would be that if an actuary is going to calculate a premium, they need to be able to estimate the expected value of claims paid to policyholders in the future, or benefits that are payable to policyholders in the future. The next element of the actuarial skill set is that it is multidisciplinary. This is what distinguishes actuaries from specialists like statisticians, data scientists, or economists. An actuarial education covers many subjects. For example, mathematics, probability and statistics, data science, finance, economics, computer science, and risk management. Many people might think being an actuary is quite a narrow thing, but the actuarial skill set is very broad. It also involves making responsible and professional decisions. And what this means is that an actuary must also understand the human, political, ethical, and leadership aspects of what they do, and they also need to communicate adequately. And just as actuaries don't need to be medical physicians to understand mortality rates, they don't need to be experts in other fields to apply their skills there. But if they're to apply their actuarial skills, they also need to demonstrate a working knowledge and big picture understanding of those fields. And having this broad skill set gives them a unique ability to do that. The third aspect of the actuarial skill set is that it is usually socially responsible. To give you an example, under the charter of the Institute and Faculty of Actuaries, members have a duty to put the public interest first. So, to be clear, this is not saying that actuaries are necessarily ethically superior than others. What it is saying is that actuaries usually have a greater ethical responsibility than others. Indeed, this is why actuaries came to exist in the first place. Let's look at a hypothetical example of an insurance company before actuaries existed. You'd have a group of self-interested individuals They're aiming to set up an insurance company and to make some money for themselves. They are aiming to make a profit, they're aiming to stay solvent so they can make more money in the future. But there's risks. There can be misalignments of interest in the firm where people can act in their own interest in a way that can hurt the firm. There can be imprudent behavior, which obviously damages the company as well. And there's other risks. What this means is that from a policyholder's perspective or member of the public perspective, they might not necessarily trust that this company will be able to pay out claims or will be able to pay the benefits that they are promised in the future. And this is where the founders of the actuarial profession came in. They wisely considered that if you add a prudent and rigorously trained professional actuary into an insurance company and you place them at an appropriate level in the company, and if you made the actuary responsible for, accountable to, and aligned their interests with that of the public interest, then things would probably be in a superior position than before. But this would usually mean that the actuary will come into conflict with others in the company who might be acting against the public interest. So they also considered that the actuary should be supported with fit-for-purpose legislation, regulations, and code of conducts so that the actuary could bear any opposition without arrogance in the performance of their duties. What it would mean would be, according to the founders of the profession, is that the insurance company would then become more likely to be able to meet their future obligations. You would have a sounder situation going on in the insurance company. And this was likely to create an ethically more progressive outcome, in that because the customers might be more likely to trust the insurance company, the insurance company can provide more valuable products to them. And also because they are able to provide those valuable products, their business is likely to grow and they're likely to make more profits. So you get a win-win situation. However, and there's a big however, there is an imperative that the character of the actuary is appropriate for the role that they have. If it's not, it causes a problem. And I'll give you an example. So if the actuary is going to behave in a kind of a base way, where they don't necessarily care, or they don't have a degree of empathy for others, then they are probably more likely to be part of the problem than part of the solution. Also, if the actuary is going to behave in a very conformist way, even though there is a system set up for them to be able to stand up to help the public interest, they're probably unlikely to stand up if that is needed. So effectively, an actuary must behave in a prudent way. What that means is that they need to be able to understand the consequences of their actions, and they need to be able to manage themselves in a way where they can perform their duties to do the right thing. This creates a lot of challenges for actuaries, and it's one of the key elements of the role, particularly if you are an actuary with a position of responsibility. Next, I'm going to show you a role play video by three of my students, Anne-Marie, Nancy, and Ronan, where they're going to show you quite an extreme situation where the chief actuary has become corrupt, but the junior actuary is able to show the courage needed to be able to do the right thing and use the structures that are in place to protect the policyholders.
Nancy is a newly qualified actuary who has recently started working for a large life insurance company named Swan Life, While working on her first big assignment in her new role, she notices something is amiss.
What the hell? This can't be right. The assets that have been designated as technical provisions are being used to guarantee company loans taken out by Swan Life. This surely must be a mistake. I need to report this immediately. Hello? I need to see the chief actuary right away. It's urgent.
Come in.
Please take a seat. What is so urgent you see me right away?
I'm working on the calculation of the technical provisions at the moment, sir. And I came across these documents showing that the assets being marked as technical provisions are also being used to guarantee millions of euros worth of loans taken out by Swan Life.
Are you finished?
What do you mean, am I finished? If this is correct and the company defaults on these loans, we won't have any technical provisions.
Well, obviously, Nancy, you've made a mistake then. Just go back and check your work.
But look, your signature's on these documents. Do you remember signing off on this?
You've no idea the amount of paperwork that goes through my desk every day.
Well, if you are so sure that I am mistaken and that everything is fine, then I'm sure you wouldn't mind if I highlighted this with the Central Bank of Ireland.
The chief actuary realises that if this information comes to the attention of the Central Bank, the company's name will be dragged through the mud and his professional reputation will be destroyed.
Don't be ridiculous. There is no issue. However, the company is facing some financial difficulties at the moment, and unfortunately, Nancy, we're going to have to let you go.
Is this because I pointed out the problem with the technical provisions? You can't just fire me over this.
Absolutely not, and there is no issue with the technical provisions. Please see yourself out immediately.
Hello. Please put me through to the director, please. This is Mr. Watt, the chief actuary. Hi there. Unfortunately, we have a whistleblower situation. I handle it, but I think it might be a good idea to spread a rumour to undermine her credibility, just in case she decides to take this public. Don't worry about it. I'll make sure that she'll never be taken seriously again.
A rumour spreads through the company like wildfire that Nancy is nothing more than a disgruntled employee seeking revenge after being made redundant. And slowly but surely, Nancy becomes inundated with emails from her old colleagues, filled with an assortment of pleas for her silence and vicious threats.
How can I speak up when there are so many people depending on these jobs to pay their bills and support their families? Swan Life is the biggest employer in the area. I don't want to be responsible for potentially ruining the lives of so many people. However, on the other hand, if Swan Life defaults on their loans and there are no technical provisions which to pay out benefits and claims, the families of those policyholders will suffer too. I really wish this were not up to me, but I just cannot sit back and do nothing. I must do the right thing and report this to the Central Bank. There, it is done. I sent my report to the Central Bank and it's out of my hands now.
The Central Bank investigate the matter and thankfully the issue is caught at a point where it can be resolved. Swan Life is fined for misconduct and the chief executive and the chief actuary are forced to resign. Going forward, Swan Life has designated appropriate assets as technical provisions, mitigating any potential damage so none of the policyholders are negatively impacted. Nancy took an unfair dismissal case against Swan Life and received appropriate compensation. Her reputation survived the ordeal and she went on to lead a successful career in the area of insurance supervision within a regulatory agency.
I'd like to thank my students, Anne-Marie Blake, Nancy Wang, and Ronan Walsh for producing that video. It shows, I think, quite well the challenges that actuaries can face, but also the inspirational roles that actuaries can also play too. Luckily, actuaries are also supported in other ways to meet their ethical challenges. For example, they usually have professionalism and ethics education. Most actuarial associations have a code of professional conduct, and usually one of the aspects of that code is that actuaries are expected to speak up. There's also procedures in place to deal with actuaries who are in breach of those codes. Usually regulators in most jurisdictions have what's called a prudent person rule, where the regulator tries to assess the characters of the key individuals in the insurance firm too. And there's also actions by individual actuaries, usually supported by their actuarial associations. For example, in recent years, a psychological test has been developed in order to assess the likelihood of an individual behaving in a prudent way or an imprudent way. It's called the Know Yourself test. It's used in practice, and we also use it as part of the ethics education for actuarial students in UCD. So, what can actuaries do? Well, we've already said that they mostly work in insurance and pensions, but there's other examples too. So we've already talked about that actuaries calculate insurance premiums. Usually there's other aspects to it. For example, in most jurisdictions, there is a principle that the customer must be treated fairly. And this is kind of a key aspect in determining the insurance premium. Another aspect of actuarial work in an insurance company is to calculate the insurance reserves. That is the amount of money that need to be set aside so that the insurance company can pay claims in the future and benefits that they have promised to policyholders. These insurance reserves are often called the technical provisions, as Nancy referred to them in the video. It's not just important that these are calculated correctly, but also that they are held in a safe way, for example, not being used as security for anything else, that they're held in a way that they are only used for the benefit of the policyholders. To varying degrees, other industries need actuaries for the same reason that the insurance and pensions industry needs actuaries. If by having involvement of actuaries of the appropriate character, if that enables companies to create greater trust among the general public and their customers, this can facilitate them to create more valuable products, which can mean that the customers get more valuable products, but also that in theory they can make more profits as well. One example of that is in data science, which is quite a new industry. Actuaries have the technical skills to be involved in this industry. Their multi-disciplinary skill set puts them in a good place to be able to work out the big picture of what's going on. And their ethical training means that they have some understanding of data ethics and the issues around ethical AI. One of the biggest challenges facing humanity at the moment is in relation to our environment. Is there a role for actuaries here? Well, for the same reason why actuaries got involved in insurance, a similar situation arguably exists here. The field of climate change has many self-interested stakeholders involved in it, but there is currently no role directly responsible to the public interest to offset the risks that can arise from other stakeholders acting in their own interest in a way that can damage the interest of humanity. So there is almost certainly a role here for actuaries to play. In summary, what is an actuary? Well, they are professionals with a skill set to make judgments about the future. The skill set has three elements to it. It's quantitative, multidisciplinary, and it is socially responsible. There's broad and growing scope for use of the actuarial skill set, and it gives those involved as actuaries an opportunity to make a positive impact on the world, but also to get reasonably well paid for it. Thank you for your attention.